Welcome to today's Georgetown Alumni Lifelong Learning Program hosted by the Georgetown University Alumni Association. Thank you for taking time out of your day to join us for this book talk with Professor Marcia Chatelain, author of Franchise, The Golden Arches in Black America. As a reminder, this session is being recorded and the recording will be shared via a follow-up email. You may also use the questions section of your GoToWebinar control panel to submit questions throughout the session. Now to our host, Lisa Collins, School of Foreign Service alumna, class of 2001, and Georgetown Law, class of 2004. Lisa Collins is a partner at Baker Hostetler and the intellectual property team leader in Atlanta. Her practice focuses on the business and defense of intellectual property, including licensing, tech transactions, indemnification, IP strategy, trade secrets, portfolio management, and patent. Trademark and technology litigation. Lisa is a thought leader and accelerator in the areas of diversity and inclusion. She leads the Atlanta Inclusion and Diversity Committee, chairs the firm-wide Black Affinity Group, and serves on the firm-wide Diversity Council and Women's Committee. Lisa also serves as the symposium co-chair and the immediate past program development chair for the Alumni Executive Council of the Leadership Council on Legal Diversity. She is a member of the 2020 class of Leadership Atlanta. Lisa is the immediate past president of the Georgetown Club of Metropolitan Atlanta and serves on the universities and law schools, Board of Governors and Law Alumni Board, respectively. She has received numerous awards and accolades for her work and leadership in the community at large, her legal acumen, and for her work to increase diversity and foster greater inclusivity. Without further ado, I'm pleased to turn things over to Lisa Collins.
Good afternoon, and thank you, Kelly, so much for that introduction. I'm excited to be here in conversation today with Dr. Marcia Chatelain to talk about her most recent book, Franchise, The Golden Arches in Black America. Marcia Chatelain is a professor of history and African American studies at Georgetown University. The author of Southside Girls, Growing Up in the Great Migration, she teaches about women's and girls' history, as well as Black capitalism. Her latest book, Franchise, The Golden Arches in Black America, examines the intricate relationship among African American politicians, civil rights organizations, communities, and the fast food industry. Last year, Professor Chatelain received the Pulitzer Prize in History, the Hagley Prize in Business History, and the Organization of American Historians Lawrence W. Levine Award for Franchise. An active public speaker and educational consultant, Dr. Chatelain has received numerous awards and honors from the Ford Foundation, the American Association of University Women, and the German Marshall Fund of the United States. At Georgetown, she has won several teaching awards. In 2016, the Chronicle of Higher Education named her a top influencer in academia in recognition of her social media campaign, #FergusonSyllabus, which employed educators to facilitate discussions about the crisis in Ferguson, Missouri. She has held an Eric and Wendy Schmidt Fellowship at New America, a National Endowment for the Humanities Faculty Fellowship, and an Andrew Carnegie Fellowship. Thank you, Dr. Chatelain, for being with us here today. We appreciate you. To our audience, I just want to remind you during the conversations, if you have any questions for Professor Chatelain, please type them in the question box on your GoToWebinar control panel. Marcia, it's wonderful to be with you here today to discuss Franchise, The Golden Arches in Black America. Your book has been described as a stunning story of post-1960s urban Black America, a tale of triumph and good intentions, but also of tragic consequences for race relations, poverty, and dietary health, and an eye-opening and unique history lesson. Within this history lesson that is Franchise, you guide us through the rise of McDonald's and fast food more generally, sharing how and why McDonald's strategically courted Black franchisees and customers during a pivotal point in our history and the corporation's history, illuminating how racial tensions, the civil rights movement, and government policies all impacted the ways the fast food industry grew and also took root in mostly Black communities. Tracing this complicated past to our present, you inform a much larger conversation about fast food and health in the US, showing how a lack of access and resources leaves certain communities unable to make better, healthier choices. So what drew you to this research? into the, which became this book. And can you share what first brought you to studying this area and how franchise came to be?
Well, thank you so much, Lisa, for facilitating this conversation, and Georgetown Alumni Office for always supporting me in my work. And thank you everyone for sharing a portion of your day to continue learning with me. You know, when I first thought about writing a book about the fast food industry, I thought that I was going to examine, you know, some of the issues that I think have become pretty well known, you know, around health, access to a varied and, you know, nutritious diet, the things that we talk about when we talk about food deserts or food apartheid. But what I soon discovered was that there was another story that I think was more helpful in terms of thinking historically about the roots of our concerns around health and nutrition. And that is, how did McDonald's, a brand that was very much associated with the suburbs and the rise of, you know, mid-century suburbia, how did it end up in the inner city? And what could that tell us about some of the solutions that we generate when we think about responding to the unfinished business of racial justice? And what I discovered was that McDonald's entering Black America was really an extension of a lot of the unfulfilled hopes and aspirations of the country after 1968, and a deep desire to see economic development and the growth of business as a way to respond to the tension of, you know, having so many legislative victories in terms of civil rights, but it not translating into the quality of people's lives.
Okay. So I think that goes right into our next question. So you write of the late 1960s push for Black capitalism and how McDonald's in particular seized on that given their interest. So can you help the audience understand what is Black capitalism?
So Black capitalism is this idea that through the growth of African-American wealth and economic opportunity, there's a possibility of closing the gap between the supposed laws that are supposed to protect all people and the lived reality of a society under racism. And, you know, since the days of legal slaveholding, there have been attempts on the parts of African Americans to kind of build wealth, build community, build resources as a way to insulate themselves from the sting of racial injustice, as well as create an infrastructure of possibility within their immediate communities. And in the late 1960s, people were really excited by the possibility that Black capitalism could serve as a vehicle for opportunity. And, you know, the reason I take up this issue in the book is that one of the problems of Black capitalism, it doesn't solve a lot of the structural inequality that caused the racial unrest of the late 1960s to begin with.
So one of the events that I remember in your book that you talked about is the Cleveland controversy in the 1960s. Can you elaborate on this conflict?
Yeah, I hope there's some folks from Cleveland in the audience. I had such a wonderful time traveling to Cleveland to collect this research. So, you know, Cleveland is its own chapter in the book because it really illustrates some of the ways that in the early 1970s, African-American communities were trying to articulate themselves as political, social, and economic entities. So the dramatics of the Cleveland chapter include a process in which an African-American man is trying to get a McDonald's franchise. And to get a franchise, whether it's the late 60s, early 70s, or today, is a really long process. You have to train at Hamburger University, McDonald's kind of in-house training program. You have to have certain financial, you have to demonstrate a certain level of financial stability. And so the controversy in Cleveland is that there are a number of McDonald's that are very successful on Cleveland's predominantly Black East Side, but they're not franchised by African Americans. And there's a real tense community boycott of McDonald's on the principle that it isn't that McDonald's is refusing service, which is a type of boycott we're used to in the early 1960s. It's that the ownership of the McDonald's isn't within the community, and that the community should have insight and input into who makes money in a Black neighborhood. And I think it really shows the crux of the ways that people were taking the ideas of Black capitalism and trying to apply them on the local level. And while all of this kind of drama is happening with the boycott, their accusations of intimidation, there's an unsolved homicide, and there's also the re-election campaign of the first Black mayor of Cleveland, Carl Stokes. And he is really at the center of this battle between McDonald's and the community. And I use that chapter to really illustrate how high stakes the entry of McDonald's into Black America felt during this time. For us today, McDonald's is everywhere. And we can't imagine for many of us a period of time where McDonald's was novel or different or, you know, really fascinating. But in this period of time, McDonald's was a very new presence in Black communities, and people fought very hard to control the terms in which McDonald's would engage in business.
What does it mean to authentically support Black business owners?
That's a great question, Lisa. I don't know. I mean, I think that this is really, you know, the McDonald's issue really blew up this question because people said, well, if you patronize a Black franchise McDonald's, is that really a Black-owned company? And from the perspective of African Americans who are entering franchising, they're really embracing this message of buy Black, and they're using that message to get people through the doors. And other people are saying, well, would a more authentically Black company be one that, you know, the CEO and the CFO and the chairman of the board and everyone is Black? And we know that in a lot of corporate structures, that's not the case. And so franchises sit in this really kind of strange position because they are owned by someone, but they're not really owned by someone. It's like I like to joke, you know, I think I own my house, but Bank of America actually owns it, right? And so those types of relationships were really at the center of people wondering about the authenticity of actually supporting a Black-owned business.
And so did some of the things you talked about, like the franchisees owning the business but not really owning the business, did that lead to tension between like corporate opportunism and Black franchisees' economic opportunity?
Yeah, you know, the franchising model is really, it can be really precarious because, you know, as a franchisee, you have to follow the rules of the franchisor, and you also absorb a lot of the liability of the business. So, you know, if you and I own a burger franchise and the price of flour goes up, so our buns are more expensive, like we have to negotiate those costs, and we likely cannot kind of find our own hamburger bun factory, right? We have to use the suppliers that the company tells us. You know, if you and I come up with an ad idea and we want to give away 50 cent hamburgers on Tuesdays, we can't just do that, right? Like the franchisor has to kind of have final approval. But in exchange, you know, there's a lot of thinking and a lot of the blueprint we don't have to come up with. So all of this is to say that, you know, within the McDonald's system during the time that I'm writing about, McDonald's franchisees, Black franchisees, really do feel like they're at a disadvantage, that they are given this incredible opportunity to build wealth, but that they feel that it is coming with the knowledge that their white counterparts are having an easier time doing business. And what's strange is, you know, when this book came out in 2020, I think people thought, wow, this is kind of a weird way of looking at civil rights. This is kind of interesting. But when the paperback was issued in 2021, this was after a moment that there had been a large lawsuit on the part of Black franchise owners against McDonald's for a lot of the issues I write about in the book. The sense that they were segregated in certain neighborhoods, that their possibility of expanding to more stores was limited, and that doing business under that system was also doing business on unequal ground.
Okay. Also in your book, you examine McDonald's history of marketing to Black communities and its lasting impact, being one of the first major advertisers to court the Black community, you know, such as featuring images of happy Black families in restaurants or embracing the new MLK Jr. holiday and campaigns. You also discuss how the tagline, "You deserve a break today," did not resonate with the Black consumers. Why was it not appealing? Why was that tagline in particular not appealing to Black consumers?
You know, McDonald's really created the gold standard of advertising, not only in the fast food industry, but I think, you know, kind of sector-wide of investing in very expensive, highly produced commercials in the late 60s and early 70s. And when Black franchisees pressured McDonald's to start advertising to Black consumers, their initial impulse was to just put Black models in, you know, print ad situations that they would for white models. And so they tried to use the You Deserve a Break Today campaign for African Americans. And when they hired Burrell Communications out of Chicago, a Black marketing and advertising firm, to, you know, analyze this ad, they said, well, people aren't going to get into this. You know, what breaks are African Americans enjoying in 1969? I mean, like, come on. You know, let's find different ways of communicating to this market. And it was wildly successful. And it was, you know, it wasn't the first in the sense that, you know, other companies had done this, but it was innovative in the fact that they were really trying to co-opt and adapt, you know, ideas of cool, you know, of Black popular culture and then later Black celebrities to populate this world that they were creating. And you know, one of the most fun parts of my research was watching old McDonald's commercials all day. You know, I was like in tears by the end of it because it was my entire childhood. And the number of African-American actors and musicians, people who were really popular when I was growing up, and to see them in this advertisement also showed the kind of the growth of the idea of crossover appeal, that ads that were initially created to target one segment of the market, the popularity of hip hop and rap music and certain R&B stars, as well as athletes, showed the capacity for Black celebrities to appeal to all audiences. And I think the pinnacle of that was, you know, Michael Jordan for McDonald's commercials throughout the 80s and 90s.
Yeah. And you just mentioned how watching the videos, the old commercials with McDonald's, how it was part of your, now you watch it, but you started to reminisce about your childhood. So growing up in Chicago, was McDonald's like a factor to you? Did you see how the research you did later on, how you can look back and see how it related to your own personal experience?
Oh, 100%. I mean, McDonald's was everywhere. It was headquartered in suburban Chicago. It's now in the city. The local organization of Black McDonald's operators were huge in Black community and cultural events. I write in the book that my first serious engagement with African American history was by way of a quiz bowl show that was sponsored by Black franchise owners. I mean, it was such a presence. And I think that this is, in some sense, a regional story, as well as a specific generational story. I remember going to college and, you know, people from Detroit or St. Louis also remembering the incredible visibility of Black franchise owners. And when I was writing this book, I would travel to different universities to give, you know, presentations on chapters of it to get feedback. And I remember once someone said, you know, as a white person, I can't imagine knowing who the franchise owner is of my local fast food restaurant. That just seems so strange to me. You know, and from my perspective, you know, this was the person who was giving out those giant novelty checks at the Lou Rawls telethon. I'm really dating myself, but, you know, these telethons that were done for historically Black colleges or the back to school parades. You know, this is very much such a visible group. And I thought it was such an interesting marker of the ways that everyone knows what McDonald's is, but McDonald's means so many different things in so many different communities. And, you know, it's like Coca-Cola in Atlanta. It's like there's no way you can miss it. And you know people who work for the corporation. You know people who are in the franchising families. It served the role that, you know, a small business would in a small town.
That's right. Within a franchise, you mentioned President and Hoya Bill Clinton's infamous penchant for McDonald's and how it was seen as part of his relatability. More recently, Trump's personal fast food taste and McDonald's spread for the Clemson Tigers was met with much derision. As a historian and pop culture consumer, what are your thoughts on fast food and the White House?
You know, fast food and the White House have always been quite chummy. You know, Richard Nixon had a good relationship with the founder of the McDonald's franchising system, Ray Kroc. And Ray Kroc really tried to pressure the Nixon administration to support legislation that would create a special minimum wage for teenagers. And there was, you know, all sorts of scandal about that. And then throughout you know, the past 50, 60 years, the White House has been a pretty close ally to the fast food industry. If you think about positions on the federal minimum wage, about, you know, the kind of lower standards of regulation on food and food supply, you know, regardless of administration, there's been a friend of fast food in the White House. Bill Clinton loved to eat McDonald's, like jog and stop for a McMuffin. I think the Obama administration kind of shook that up a little bit because of Michelle Obama's efforts through Let's Move. You know, kind of embedded in her approach to childhood nutrition is a critique of the fast food industry. And Barack Obama was more of a Shake Shack kind of guy than a McDonald's kind of guy. And so there's a way that these lenses of personal food taste and kind of policy positions and proximity to kind of McDonald's is part of it. But there are a number of people who left the Obama administration who now work for McDonald's. So, like, let's be really clear that it's not that clear cut. President Trump loves McDonald's. Apparently he eats the Big Macs without the buns, is what I think my husband told me that the other day. I think it is, you know, a national atrocity to serve fast food in the White House, not because the food is so terrible, but by the time it's served, it's cold. Like, fast food has to be eaten immediately. And so when I saw the thing with the Clemson Tigers, I was like, this is really bad, because this food's probably been sitting out for a hot minute. And so I was very opposed to that position. As opposed to a number of positions of the Trump White House, but that one was one that was in my recent wheelhouse that I could definitively you know, say was a really poor decision.
So, I mean, the book obviously talks about franchise, right? And so McDonald's is a central facet of it. So were there any challenges of writing a social history that is connected and intertwined with an existing corporation? Because presumably they were, they want to be cautious and aware of how they're perceived. So did you have any challenges in that regard?
You know, the kind of first challenge was I had no access to McDonald's internal records. McDonald's has a full-time archivist and their own kind of, you know, collections of historical material. I didn't have access to it, which I think was really such a wonderful challenge. Like, how was I going to tell this story without McDonald's kind of giving me access? And the reality is that McDonald's has been such a presence in Black communities. Their stuff is everywhere. In every kind of major collection of Black civil rights groups, Black leaders, Black mayors, there's something about McDonald's. And so I really was excited about the kind of detective work that goes into it. That's the best part of being a historian. You know, I kept a lot of the material goes into the early 90s. That's probably one of the best kind of strategies of writing about an existing corporation. You know, everything I said was documented very carefully. I think that, you know, I think that McDonald's doesn't go after low-hanging fruit like me. Also, there was a period of time I remember in the 80s and early 90s when McDonald's would sue environmentalists for critiquing kind of their impact in terms of production of waste and, you know, being in the business of selling beef, and, you know, they would pursue these people. I don't know if, I mean, who's going to come after me? I mean, I don't think that is the move anymore, but I do think that, you know, they do feel challenged by this research, not because it's saying that, you know, fast food is evil and no one should eat it, but it's also, but it's questioning a kind of approach to racial justice that I think is important. You know, McDonald's became a fixture in Black America by way of Martin Luther King Jr.'s assassination. And I think that those two events then puts McDonald's into a civil rights story that they don't belong in. And I would argue that no corporation belongs into, right? That we have incredible opportunities and creativity to answer these questions about, you know, how do we get people on equal ground? And I just don't think it comes through the fast food industry, and I don't think it comes through franchising. And that's where McDonald's and I, you know, disagree.
What is McDonald's and the fast food industry's responsibility in general to consumers?
You know, I think about this a lot, and I think about where the onus and the responsibility comes from. I want McDonald's to focus on making burgers. I want them to focus on their French fries. And I want us to live in a society where our federal government and our federal system provides a baseline quality life for all people. So we don't have to get stressed out about what McDonald's is doing. Meaning, you know, if we had a living wage, that's just a federal requirement. This is the cost of doing business. If we didn't have so many corporate loopholes for paying taxes, if we had free childcare, paid sick leave, you know, parks in every community, senior centers in every community, access to a diverse and varied diet, then the presence of McDonald's wouldn't feel so stressful, right? But when we have corporations determining the quality of human life, whether a person can take the day off if they're sick or to take care of their child, then we have these incredible imbalances. And so we find ourselves, you know, lobbying corporations to do the right thing rather than trusting that we have a federal system that ensures that the right thing is just available to all of us.
Understood. So how do we address the larger health issues, the lack of access and therefore choice in certain communities for food?
Yeah, I mean, I think that the incentives that are available to the fast food industry have to be available to supermarkets. You know, could we imagine a system of having, you know, government get in the business of supermarkets? Maybe it's something they should think about. You know, they're in the business of food subsidies and food regulation. You know, could we imagine a kind of nonprofit, low-cost food supply system for every person in America? That could be a wonderful solution. But I think as it stands, you know, grocery stores are really tricky business because they have an incredible amount of inventory that goes bad and you have to do something with it. Grocery stores left a lot of inner city communities in the late 1960s because of, you know, depopulation, because of high cost of operating business, low margins, and a sense that, you know, this isn't where the money is. And what goes in is fast food, because you can do really well in communities. And the food that comes into fast food is often shelf stable. They have the supply chain to keep on, you know, bringing it in. You don't lose a lot in that system. And so I think that what we have to do is really commit to broad solutions that are about, again, using and appealing to the public good to feed people, instead of saying, okay, this one neighborhood after, you know, there's some neighborhoods in this country that after 40 years, a grocery store comes in. And that grocery store is coming in order to facilitate more high income, high earning people to come in, not to feed the people in that community. And I think as long as supermarkets become, you know, the canary in the coal mine for gentrification and for displacement, then we'll never really see supermarkets as the place that is just necessary to feed people who need food.
If you can pick one aspect of your book based on the research and you writing the story that you did, what would you say was the most impactful part that you learned during your journey in writing this book?
You know, it's funny. I think I became deeply empathetic to the advocates of fast food, not because I necessarily agreed with them, but because I started to appreciate and understand the enormity of what this opportunity meant for African-American business people in the 60s. They didn't know how this story was going to end, and they couldn't see around the corner. And I don't think they could have imagined some of the negative impacts that fast food has had on both consumers and employees. But, you know, a few weeks ago, I was talking about the book and I said, you know, it's like if Mark Zuckerberg flew me out to California and he was like, you know what, you can now have Facebook. That's how like inconceivable someone who grows up in Jim Crow America sees the gains of the civil rights movement and someone sits down and says, you can own a McDonald's. It's unfathomable. And so, you know, with that, people are doing the best that they can, but they're operating in a system and in a structure that can't fully deliver the promises. The other thing I will say is when, before COVID canceled everything, when I was on the road with the book, I remember an older Black woman in Kansas City, you know, she said, I remember the first time I went to McDonald's. I remember having ice cream at McDonald's on a date. And it was so powerful because, you know, I grew up in the Jim Crow South and my grandmother wouldn't let us go get ice cream because she didn't want us standing in front of a window that said colored only. And so she's like, so we made homemade ice cream. And when McDonald's came to Kansas City and she could just go get an ice cream, this was like really meaningful for her. And so one of the things that I try to do when I do this with my students at Georgetown is to say, like, there are things that we may disagree with or are uncomfortable with or don't understand. But if something is meaningful to another person, we have to take seriously where that meaning comes from. And I think hearing these stories about McDonald's has definitely opened up both my mind and my heart to that reality.
Thank you so much. Now we're going to take some questions from the audience. And so let's move to the ones that they've queued up for you. Just as a reminder to everybody in the audience, if you have any questions, please put them in the question section of your GoToWebinar control panel. So the first question that we have in the queue is, given your research and teaching of Black capitalism, could you talk about barriers and opportunities for Black entrepreneurs today, especially in the DC region?
You know, so it's kind of amazing, because the same things that we talk about today were just met, were the same problems in the past. It's undercapitalization. Banks are not lending on favorable terms. They're not lending at the right size to really support business. That's the first thing. The second is there's immense pressure on Black businesses to participate as members of a community and to address issues that most Black businesses don't have the capacity to do. You know, we saw after the George Floyd summer, all of this, you know, support Black creators, support Black business, which is fine, but most Black businesses in the United States are sole proprietorships that do not employ more than one person, right? And that's often sometimes the owner. So if we're talking about the opening of Black business as a way to open jobs up in communities, you need a lot of businesses. You need a lot of capital. And you need to make sure that if we're going to say supporting Black business creates a social good, that these businesses have the capacity to pay living wages, to have really good benefits in healthcare, and participate in the community. I think what we see today and what happened to a lot of these Black franchise owners is that they are engaged in riskier lending and borrowing practices, and some lost their franchises, but they are also trying to lift up communities that have been sorely left behind. So they're donating to everything. They're being asked to do a lot of things. And so I think that those are some of the kind of dangers and pitfalls of conceptualizing Black business as the vehicle to elevate communities, rather than one of many businesses, right, that can exist in society, where again, we have a robust social safety net that is ensuring that, you know, people are taken care of.
Understood.
And just to say it to DC, I mean, the incredible cost of living in Washington, DC, and then the surrounding area, and then, you know, the incredible cost of commercial spaces in DC, I think make this particularly challenging for Black business.
Did the McDonald's Corporation help you or resist you in your research of their company's history for this product? Oh, we did that, actually.
Yeah, they didn't help me resist.
I have a question related to that maybe they're asked. Since you've written the book, have they reached out to you about it?
You know, I hear from all sorts of people in the McDonald's system. Sometimes employees of the corporate office would, you know, go to my events. There are people who have had negative experiences with franchising or with McDonald's who, you know, read my book and say, you know, that's not the half of it. I'm going to tell you what went down. You know, McDonald's, it's funny, different people within the McDonald's system react differently to it. They had kind of made a comment that, you know, they felt like it was an inaccurate representation of their commitment to diversity, which I don't think that, I think it's just a view. I don't think there's nothing inaccurate, but it's just a perspective. But what's interesting is the number of people who have stories, you know, the number of Black business people who have real war stories involving their time and trying to break into the system has been really fascinating. And it's not just McDonald's, it's across the franchising landscape of, you know, barriers, of disappointments, of real conflicts about how to access this business. Because if you look at a lot of the kind of Black publications, particularly like Black Enterprise, Essence, Ebony, all of the kind of legacy publications, there are a lot of coverage of franchising. and it's often presented as the next best opportunity for African Americans. So a lot of people have tested out getting into franchising, even if it's not at the high level of McDonald's, your H&R Block, Krispy Kreme, Chick-fil-A. I meet a lot of people who have pursued these routes.
So the Black-White wealth gap has widened in the last 10 years. In your opinion, has Black franchising helped to narrow this gap? If not, why not? Also, was it a major goal to narrow the Black-White wealth gap by franchising?
So this is a really good and tough question. So when we talk about wealth gap, I think usually the indicator is, how much wealth a person has, assets minus debts, including wealth. And there is sometimes often a vision that a franchise will help close that gap because it can create a generational asset. And so what a lot of franchise owners, hope to do is not just have one restaurant, many restaurants, and they have a big portfolio and they can give it to the next generation. Franchising, even if every Black person in America got a very successful franchise tomorrow, that generational wealth, you wouldn't be able to catch up, because it isn't just kind of the wealth as it is today. There's wealth that appreciates through investment. There's the appreciation of real estate. And we also know about the disparities within kind of real estate and loan terms, even among African Americans with wealth. So it's like the idea that you kind of close the wealth gap through these huge business opportunities, it doesn't quite work like that. But the vision and the possibility of creating generational wealth is very much part of why people are enticed by franchising. But franchising is a risky investment, like any kind of investment. There's some real risks involved, and very few people will clear the bar to qualify for McDonald's. Sometimes you need to have $500,000, depending on the market, $500,000 liquid. The initial application fee can be up, somewhere between $40,000 and $50,000. There aren't a lot of people who are able to do that. And there are programs to help with the financing. But even if you were to able to access that, the wealth that is compounding that you will never catch up with is what keeps the gap continued. And it's history. And there's nothing we can do about history.
Well, how would we close the wealth gap if we could, systematically, right? For the systems that are in place currently, what would need to be done to do that?
I think that there would have to be some large scale reparation structure. This is a Georgetown crowd. So someone here I know works for the Biden administration. We have to cancel student debt. We're not gonna even close the wealth gap by doing that, but that one move will be able to alleviate the financial pressures that keep a lot of Black people, particularly Black women, from participating in other parts of the economy and building wealth. If I were to launch my congressional campaign today, we've got to cancel the debt. We need a mechanism for free college. We need free childcare, and we need paid sick leave. And then we'll see amazing things happen.
So Don Thompson was CEO of McDonald's and an African American. How did Black franchisee owners fare under his leadership?
Don Thompson's leadership is something I don't talk about in the book, but this is something that a lot of people have talked about. They felt very seen by him. He had a lot of experience within the McDonald's system. Another man named Bob Beavers, who passed away a few years, they felt like there was a consistent level of outreach, not only to Black consumers, but engagement with Black franchisees. Don Thompson led McDonald's during a difficult time where it had lost market share. And there was a sense that after his departure, McDonald's really kind of was less engaged with Black franchise owners and with Black customers. And in 2029, McDonald's launched a campaign called Black and Positively Golden. And that was one of their kind of first targeted campaigns to Black consumers in about two decades. I think that they had kind of taken for granted that they had, they had presence in Black markets and that was going to be enough. And if you read the legal filing of the racial discrimination case that involves about 51 or 52 Black franchise owners against McDonald's, they say that, the number of Black franchisees had been declining and McDonald's was not particularly concerned about that issue.
Okay. Within your research, did you find anything about McDonald's attempts to offer more healthy food?
You know, this is something that happens in the, you know, it isn't really until the 1990s where the Surgeon General is issuing, at the time, David Satcher, who's the first Black Surgeon General, you know, starts issue warnings about overconsumption of fast food. And there's some, you know, kind of pivot towards health. I think the problem with the healthy foods at fast food is that people don't go to McDonald's to eat a salad. And it especially took shape after the film Super Size Me got so popular that McDonald's got rid of the Super Size option. And then you start to see the introduction of apple slices and Happy Meals, you know, the rolling out of more salads. Sometimes some of those measures that were considered kind of healthier measures weren't just a response to the critique of the quality of the food, but also to try to get adults to eat more McDonald's. This has always kind of been part of the focus of McDonald's market research. How do you get grown-ups to also want to eat there when their kids get older? And so, you know, the more premium burgers and, you know, now McDonald's makes fewer kind of attempts to say that there are certain foods that they have are healthy, but they focus on supply, all natural, whole white meat, you know, a focus on ingredients. And I think that really does follow the way that consumers talk about food. Lisa and I are the same class here in college, so we're probably very close to the same age. You know, we grew up in an era in the 80s and 90s where no one ate butter. It was all margarine. No one ate eggs. Eggs were not good for you. You know, whole white bread was kind of thrown out, and low-fat diets were very popular. And then low-carb diets got really popular. And I think that we're in an era, probably because we've been through a lot as a people the past few years, where people are more indulgent. And they want just good quality ingredients, but there is less of an obsession of too much carbs, too much fat. And, you know, the kind of Instagram culture around food is about quality indulgence versus, you know, diet foods.
Right. That's definitely true, because butter is back.
I know, butter is back. I didn't have butter until I was an adult.
Right. We had margarine.
Yeah, margarine is so gross. And, right. You know, yeah, that's exactly, you know, that kid of the 80s, oatmeal every day, that kind of stuff.
That's funny. That's true, too. So the next question is, while this discussion is focused more on fast food franchising, did you find anything in your research about internal unwritten rules of operating a fast food business, such as girls up front, meaning put a female at the cash register or as an order taker, which has been further interpreted as white girls up front? Further compounding the issue, did you come across such practices within the industry in your research?
Yeah, that's interesting that you say that. So when the McDonald's brothers had their kind of original, very popular McDonald's in San Bernardino, they closed for a little bit and they restructured the kitchen, they streamlined the menu, and they took girls out of the restaurant. They said that, you know, having car hops on roller skates, they flirted and they caused problems. And, you know, so for a very long time, women and teenage girls did not work at fast food. And it was, some people say it was the Black franchisees who brought them back into the stores. I don't know if that's fully true, but I did hear from one Black woman who was a very successful McDonald's manager who said, you know, there was a time as a Black woman, you couldn't become a manager at McDonald's because, you know, people didn't see you that way. And it was working for a Black franchisee that she was able to work up through the ranks. So there were these kind of different kind of ideas and protocol of who should be working in fast food. And the Black franchisees were insistent on bringing Black women into the system. There was also, you know, a sense of kind of, you know, this is a job for young people. And I think what happened in the 80s and 90s is that, you know, people became more aware that fast food was a service sector job that was highly feminized, and that was the jobs of the working poor. And I think that one of the dangers that still lingers when we talk about the minimum wage, when people think of minimum wage jobs, they think of teenagers who are just trying to get money to spend. You know, they could be babysitting, but, you know, working people in fast food and other service sectors are, you know, people who are supporting families.
Did local communities understand the importance of supporting the minority owners of the local franchises?
Yes, they were very invested in it, and people were really proud. you know, if you look at the archives of Black newspapers, they often wrote stories about these guys, and they were heroes. They had scholarships, they were providing jobs. And so people were very, very supportive of these businesses and took a great deal of interest in how the business was doing. And so there was, for a period of time, if you franchised McDonald's, you were required to be at the store. That was like your only job. And now, you know, you can have a portfolio of many stores and have an operating office. But, you know, in those days, it really did mean a lot to the community. And Black franchisees were public figures in local communities. People knew who they were, and they were very engaged.
Well, thank you so much for this discussion. I want to thank the Georgetown Alumni Office, Kelly and Allie in particular, for all of your help and your efforts involved in this discussion. Thank you so much, Marcia. We greatly appreciate your time. Your words and the book. I think, as we talked about, you know, previously before we started, I found it very interesting, especially the integration of civil rights and politics with franchises, because I had never put it together that way so much. And so I found that very interesting and enlightening. So thank you so much for your time.
Thanks so much, Lisa. Bye-bye.